Yeah, on.
Two twins. Yeah. Play it, Herb. Play it. Come on, Herb. Go, Herb, go. Go, Herb, go. Herb just doesn't stop, does he? Herb kind of only knows one gear, doesn't he? Welcome to Two Twins in an Album. Toph, how are ya? I am splendid. Episode 6, is that right?
Six.
Which is kind of miraculous that we made it this far.
I would say miraculous is a fair description. It's good to be with you again to discuss another really important album review.
Or I guess I should say that's pretty miraculous, eh?
Yeah, we'll be taking a little trip to Canada tonight. You know, it's funny, I was with somebody the other day and they were reliving stories of going to Canada, which those who listen to us know we're from the Metro Detroit area of Michigan, and going to Canada is part of our culture. It's not something that you just sort of dabble in. You and I have spent quite a bit of time with our lovely neighbors to the north, and tonight we'll spend a little more time musically with our neighbors to the north.
Well, and it had nothing to do with the drinking age of 19. Nothing to do with that.
No.
As far as why we would... I mean, Windsor, Ontario is a beautiful city.
We were mostly going there to search for moral purpose.
See the sights.
Had nothing to do with, you know, a bunch of bars on a street that were virtually 25 minutes away.
No.
Do the whole dance at customs, both to and from. It was quite an ordeal, but it always felt worth it for some reason.
Well, we have a couple good custom stories that we don't have time for on this podcast.
But I'll tell you who really won in terms of the whole Canada idea is tonight's artist. Tonight, we're really looking forward to focusing on a Canadian artist, so we cannot wait to talk about Gordon Lightfoot. I mean, that Gordon Lightfoot, man, is he something else.
Oof. Unbelievable.
The true voice of Canada.
Yeah, it's going to be a great episode.
No, we're not going to talk about Gordon Lightfoot, but what we are going to do right now is go round and round. Ah, Rat. Not a Canadian band.
No.
Rat, not from Canada.
I fully assume they're from Los Angeles?
That would be my guess. But let's go run around. T, what have you been listening to in the last week?
The band. Their album Cahoots, which starts out with their classic Life is a Carnival, one of my favorite band tunes. And it's always difficult to pick which album you want to digest from that incredible group. But of recent, I've kind of gone with Cahoots as one of the go-tos from them. The second is the band Sloan, who I think I've mentioned one other time during What's in Your Head here on the old podcast here. And their album Commonwealth, which came out just a handful of years ago. And what was cool about this album is... each member of the band got a side. So it was a four-sided album. And, you know, one was all written and sung by Jay Ferguson, the other by Chris Murphy, the other by Patrick Pentland, and the other by Andrew Scott, which, of course, with him, it ended up being an 18-minute song, which is very cool. And, you know, just another, I really love this album, and it was a really cool effort from a really great band who didn't always put out great albums top to bottom, but Commonwealth, certainly one of their better efforts. And the third album was my album of the year in 2016 by the Devin Townsend Project, who I think I've mentioned him on What's in Your Head before as well. And his album Transcendence, which I think Probably by far is top to bottom Devin's best work.
I see a theme in yours. There's a theme.
What? What? Who? What?
There's a theme to your round and round.
No, I mean, no, I didn't plan that or anything like of the sort.
All Canadian artists from all Young right. Toaf tonight. All Canadian right. artists.
You got me. You got me. I did it.
And three very, very good ones. The band, you know, they were okay, I guess. Not bad.
Yeah. I mean, they tried hard.
Round and Round for me tonight starts with Fear Factory's album Digimortal. This is from 2001. So kind of seen maybe as the last album of their heyday. And it's got Invisible Wounds, which is a song that I've always loved. And Lynchpin, another jam. And huge Fear Factory fan. So I've been continuing to enjoy that album. Chris Forsythe and the Solar Motel Band. Really cool group here. Chris Forsythe is a kind of a cosmic rock guitarist, certainly leaning towards the prog thing, and Dreaming in the Non-Dream is an album that this group put out the last few years. A lot of great instrumental stuff, just with a really tight outfit. People should check out Chris Forsythe. It's worth your time. And then the 1994 effort from Yes Talk, which is probably my top three Yes albums. It's a great album. It's kind of a summer album for me. It's like the one Yes album I can listen to during the summer. I think it reminds me of when I saw them on this tour in June of 1994.
A couple of great songs on that album. And, you know, if you like that Trevor Rabin era of Yes, obviously Talk is a key part of that era for them. On the previous one, did you say that he wore a tight outfit, or that the band was a tight outfit? I wasn't clear on that.
It's a good clarification. They were a tight outfit.
Oh, the band. Okay.
Toaf, what happened to the 90s? Why is it that virtually every other decade contains a real connectable nostalgia with young listeners? You know, if you think about young listeners still listen to music from the 60s, when you think about the Beatles and the Stones and the 70s, there's lots to explore from the 1970s. The 1980s continuously have revivals, and that sound, you know, is virtually being reproduced by a number of artists today. What's with the 90s? Why are the 90s just ignored? Why aren't we seeing any nostalgia boom from 90s music? Maybe with the exception of Nirvana. But aside from that, there were a lot of other bands in the 90s.
I think that we will. I think we're in that kind of in between where it's not yet classic. It's sort of still that time period that hasn't yet gotten nostalgic enough. So I think there will get to a point where, you know, the grunge era stuff becomes sort of like our classic rock when we were growing up. You know, certainly one of the things worth considering is whether or not the 90s era, particularly the rock type era, if it is going to have appeal, because what really made 90s rock what it was its minimalism. It was about stripping things down, you know, being fairly bare bones and making it work with grit and feeling rather than emphasis on layering and melody. And I think that's, you know, part of why the 80s still works is because a lot of that's electronic. And, you know, to the ear of many younger people right now, you know, that kind of makes sense. Right now, when you listen to some of that 90s rock, I could see a younger person's ear kind of thinking that it's dull or that it's thin. And that was what we loved about it, was its minimalism. And, you know, back then you didn't have to rely on this layering and these muscle additions to a song to kind of provide it with feeling. It just kind of had that in a more genuine, stripped down nature.
I think you make some good points about the production. In the mid to late 90s, when tonight's album was released, albums were produced to sound good on radio and to sound good on speakers that were moderate size in a car or home stereo systems that were very often playing CDs and maybe rarely cassettes, but a lot of times they were playing radio. So production elements were put in place for music to sound good on radio and to sound good coming out of TV speakers because it was also on MTV. Nowadays, albums are produced to sound good on a speaker the size of a fingernail or smaller. And in a lot of cases, that speaker is directly inside of somebody's ear. So there's a huge difference in production, but I actually have a different theory and I want to run it by you. One of the things that I've certainly noticed about music today and in the last few years, it's this genre that I call festival rock. And the main quality of festival rock is the main quality of what I hear in all of today's music, which is that it has to be danceable. It's got to have this danceable beat. It's got to have this thump to it. And you got to be able to dance to it.
And it's got to have keyboards and it's got to have swirly elements. Yeah.
Yeah. The beauty of the mid to late 1990s and the beauty of tonight's album is it was a smash hit and became mainstream and it wasn't danceable. And all of today's music feels like it needs to be something you could dance to or something you can jump up and down to at a festival full of people and turn your phone around on yourself and look really cool while you're doing it. And that's kind of what the big, you know, contradiction is between the era that we're going to look at tonight and where we're living in right now. Tonight's album came out in 1997. It's 23 years old. 23 years when we were growing up was a time period that you would consider classic, and things from the early 70s by the mid 90s felt classic. The mid to late 90s sound, I think you nailed it talking about some of the minimalist aspects. But one of the things that I noticed when I spent a lot of time re-exploring Clumsy is how good music sounds on compact disc. Because anytime we do this, I listen to the album in its native format. And the native format for Clumsy is CD. Man, music sounded good on CD. You know, it really is a pure waveform audio. It makes you realize how crappy things sound on MP3. And we all love MP3s because they're convenient and you can fit thousands of them onto a device. But listening to this album really took me back to a place where mid to late 90s albums sounded so good on compact disc. It's something that I certainly miss. And this reminded me of that. T, you ready to go to Canada?
Well, good day, mate.
That's Australia, but you know, it's all the same, right?
Oh, sorry.
T, do you want to take the Ambassador Bridge or do you want to take the tunnel? Call right now. Which do you want to take?
The bridge or the tunnel? Let's go with the tunnel.
All right, let's take the tunnel there and we'll take the bridge back. How's that sound?
That's fine. Just make sure to act nice and sober when we get to customs.
All right, let's take that tunnel underneath the Detroit River and let's get into tonight's nerdy deets.
You want some dirty deets? Yeah. You want some nerdy deets?
Nerdy deets done dirt cheap. Our Lady Peace was formed in Toronto, as one might expect, in 1992. Really started with guitarist Mike Turner, the original guitarist for the band. Michael Maida, who would eventually become known as Rain Maida, who was studying criminology at the University of Toronto.
So did he come up with the name Rain? Or
he did. He did, because he didn't want to have two Mikes in the band. So particularly since they were the two original founding members, I think Michael Maida realized that he didn't want to be the second Mike in the band, so he assigned himself the name Rain. So it became Rain Maida, and the two formed Our Lady Peace. Now, they went through some different lineup shifts, but eventually landed on Duncan Coutts on bass guitar and Jeremy Taggart on drums. And we'll talk a little bit more about Jeremy Taggart as we go, who joined the band at 17 years old. And that rounded out what everyone I think would consider the classic Our Lady Peace lineup. They've had lineup shifts since then. Unfortunately, Mike Turner left the band Very unfortunately, Jeremy Taggart left the band a few years ago, and now it's sort of Rain Maida and other guys. Jeremy Taggart, being 17 years old, caused some issues when he first joined the band. As we already referenced, the drinking age in Canada was 19. They played a lot of bars, and being a 17-year-old, there were some pretty strict rules about him not being able to play. So Our Lady Peace early on had to do quite a bit of finagling just to get Jeremy Taggart to play certain shows at certain locations because he was so young.
So young, yet so important to this band.
So important to this band. Jeremy Taggart has gone on to become sort of a Canadian celebrity. He's the host of a very successful podcast. It's called Taggart and Torrens. For anyone who hasn't listened to it, it is a terrific podcast. The last thing I would want to do ever is to take people away from listening to two twins in an album. But I recommend Taggart and Torrens to anybody. It's a very free-form discussion. Jeremy Taggart's got this really great delivery. For those who don't remember him, he was kind of famous for wearing black-rimmed glasses and he had long, curly hair. He was a very visible member of the band. But he's also got this really distinct voice. This almost sort of like nerdy delivery, and he's very, very smart and incredibly funny. And he's gone on to now become kind of a celebrity in Canada, more for his podcast role than being the drummer of Our Lady Peace for so many years.
He is a ridiculously likable guy, both in his podcast, and you can go back and even listen to, you know, interviews while he was still a part of the band. And every time he talks, it kind of makes sense and you kind of nod your head and it's like, yeah, it's a good point. You know, one of those guys, very likable dude.
But do you know what Jeremy Taggart in the end is probably most famous for? It is for an appearance in a video of a song that he didn't even play on.
That's right.
And so I was already an Our Lady Peace fan, but Nickelback became huge. Remember Nickelback, Canadian band as well. A band you and I both very much like. Chad Kroeger goes on to make this song for this movie. And so you might flip on MTV one day at some point, and you might hear a little bit something like this.
I am so high, I can hear ever. Right.
And this video was immensely popular on MTV. And if you notice, you watch the video and they're showing the other musicians, and all of a sudden it's like, hey, that's the Our Lady Peace drummer playing drums with the Nickelback guy. And I remember it was like, whoa, like, you know, how did this happen? As it turns out, Jeremy Taggart did not play drums on that song. Matt Cameron played drums on that song, the Pearl Jam drummer, Soundgarden drummer. Matt Cameron was unavailable to do the video shoot. Chad Kroeger was totally stuck with literally no drummer. So he calls up his fellow Canadian friend, Jeremy Taggart. He says, hey, Jeremy, I'll pay you $10,000 to come and do this video shoot for this song I'm doing for Spider-Man. Can you come do it? And Jeremy Taggart's like, yeah, like, sure, no problem. And he became incredibly famous for being in this video. The video got so much airplay. The song was a gigantic hit.
Huge hit.
Huge, and a great song. A song that I still really like. And Jeremy Taggart's in the video playing drums. He had just learned this song literally hours before it. I mean, he's basically mimicking a song that he just learned. And he became really visible and quite famous for being in a music video for a song he didn't even play on. So Jeremy Taggart goes on to become this sort of celebrity for these very interesting reasons. And as we'll talk about, very important part of the band. There is a fifth member of Our Lady Peace, or at least Rain Maida.
But how can that be?
Look what love gave us.
World for I'm not gonna stand here away.
And the other guy, the guy that he duetted with, Josie Scott, was in which band?
Saliva.
Saliva, that's right.
Another band that I really like from that era.
Now, he was in the video and he actually did sing on the album, right? On the song.
So here's what's great. It's another great story about this video. Josie Scott sang on the song. did a great job. His voice was, a key part of the popularity of that song. Josie Scott shows up for the video and he's like, what, am I just going to like stand here and sing? And he was okay with that, but apparently the director really had an issue with this. So they give Josie Scott an acoustic guitar. Mm. He does not know how to play guitar at all. If you watch the video, he's holding it left-handed and he's playing much like a person who you can tell doesn't have a clue how to play a guitar, but they thought it was important for him to have an instrument too. So he's sort of like fake strumming along with this guitar while he's singing. You got the drummer who didn't play on the song and he just learned it a few hours before.
This is what happens when the Hollywood movie machine gets involved with the music video, these type of things.
Yeah, it certainly is. And if you remember the video, at its time, it's very high tech. They're on the top of a building. I'm sure the whole thing was fake, of course, but, or maybe it wasn't. And they've got the screen with the Spider-Man clips, you know, very strategically spliced into certain moments of the song. It's actually a great video, but... hero. So that's Jeremy Taggart. Our Lady Peace had what at least Rain Maida considers a fifth member. And I will tell you who this person is in song. Okay. And the song is very important to this gentleman. And that song is I get chills when I'm with you. Do you know? Now, what is that? You know that one?
Of course, that's Sheriff.
Sheriff, Sheriff, when I'm with you. Oh, there we go. Yeah, it's right here, Doug. No, baby.
Yeah, yeah. It's a great, that's a beautiful song. Oh, wait, here's the key change. Hang on. Can't turn it down. Do, do, do. Pop, 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 pop. Do. Ugh. You know, absolutely, when I get chills? I get chills when I listen to that song.
When I listen to Sheriff. Don't forget, too, the bit in the verse that you just pass it up in the clip, but there's a... there's another bit where he goes up high. Is it another? Is there a baby? Oh, it's ooh, babe.
I found it. Here it is. Huge. Now that the world is ending, it's love that I'm sending. Oh, sorry. That was something else.
Sheriff, What I'm With You, written by Arnold Lanny. Arnold Lanny, the producer and considered to be the fifth member of Our Lady Peace, paramount to the Our Lady Peace sound. Arnold Lanny, somebody who's very, very well respected in music, produced several other bands, and someone who's an expert in songs. But he also brought some textures to this band that come through very clear on Clumsy. So Arnold Lanny is a big part of this album, really significant part of this band. After the Spiritual Machines album, it ended that era and the band went on to work with Bob Rock and became a completely different band, a much more polished kind of hit-making machine, more than what they were at the time of the recording and release of Clumsy. Clumsy followed the real smash success of Navid, the 1994 debut album, which was really boosted by two singles, but primarily the lead single, which was Starseed. And Starseed was a pretty extraordinary song when it was released. It was very, very different from a lot of things at the time. And I'm sure we'll get into some of our early work with Our Lady Peace, some of our early connections with Our Lady Peace.
Yeah, it'll probably come with the Wonder Stories, but Starseed was a song that you in particular found very early.
Very early. This was indeed a band that that I discovered very early compared to when most of the rest of, certainly the area we were growing up in, but I would say most of probably American listeners discovered
You know, there's a song that I found early.
What's that song?
I found that one early.
There were five singles released on Clumsy, Superman's Dead, Clumsy, the title track, Automatic Flowers, Carnival, and eventually, 11 months after the album was released, which says a lot, Toph, 4 a.m. Which shows you a number of things, including the longevity of the success of this album. Oh, yeah.
No question.
Let's find out how you discovered Our Lady Peace as we transition into tonight's wondrous stories.
Sorry.
Hey, what's your Our Lady Peace story?
Often I could overhear a lot of the, you know, ridiculous music that you were playing at times. I remember like,
hey, what do you call them ridiculous? What do you call them ridiculous?
Well, you know, and look, as I've said before on the old podcast here that, you know, my brain just wasn't ready for this. So, I mean, this is not an insult. You know, I wish, you know, I could have understood some of that music that you understood at that ripe young age. But, you know, I would hear you'd be listening to King Crimson or, you know, Wigwam or, you know, old Genesis stuff. And I'd be kind of like, what's he doing over there? You know, what is this? But I remember also when you first played Starseed and it was like, okay, I don't know who this band is, but I like them. I just know I like them and, you know, got into the Navid record a little bit. But when Clumsy came out, it was a big deal for me. Our Lady Peace became one of my favorite bands at that time. As things went on, you know, they fizzled out quite a bit, but, important album and one that probably is up there as far as, you know, number of spins during that time period. Our Lady Peace Clumsy was a big one for me. How about yourself? Even though I already kind of, you know,
yeah,
told your wonder story.
Starseed was a very early discovery. We had a radio station. We have a radio station in Metro Detroit that certainly used to identify itself as alternative rock radio. I don't really know what its current form it is, but 89X, 88.7. Really, really important radio station in the 1990s for all music lovers. It was kind of the station where you go to hear what was new at the time, but also what was really hot just from the last few years. And Starseed started to receive rotation on that station pretty early on, even before Navid came out. And it was one of those songs that when you hear it, you just connect to it. I mean, there was something about that song, the verses and the chorus, the way that everything weaved into the next part. It was just a really well done song. And so, yeah, Starseed really connected very strongly. By the time Clumsy came out, it was really anticipated. I actually bought it on Canadian import from its original Canadian release date. You know, rarely do you have prized possessions that are CDs. I'm really proud of my CD copy of Clumsy because it's from the Canadian label. The back is written in French. That always reminds me, oh, I bought this album, you know, before this band really got huge.
89X does still exist, but much to your chagrin, I think they play a lot of festival rock.
yeah.
So, and by the way, I was going to say this earlier, but your coining of the phrase festival, I think you came up with that.
Yeah, I never heard that before. Yeah.
So I think dare I call it a Two Twins and an Album exclusive. You heard it here first. But I actually do think it's a perfect description and kind of funny of this current genre of music. Festival rock. Trademark Nubs on that one.
Let's drop the needle and let's get into Our Lady Peace's Clumsy.
When the drum beats go like this.
The album starts with acoustic guitar and a song that was described to me in the time that it came out as that new Smashing Pumpkins song. Clumsy kicks off with Superman's Dead.
I'm thinking why,
somebody comes out to me and says, man, I heard that new Smashing Pumpkins song, Subway. And I'm like, oh no, really? It's a song that's a pretty amazing lesson in dynamics. You know, you talk about the quiet, loud, loud, quiet thing that's going on in here. It kind of shows you why it was a hit then. It also really explains why it could never be a hit today. I mean, this is the furthest thing from festival rock that you might get. It starts with acoustic guitar, very powerful refrain at the end of the song that becomes sort of the hook of the song. It's extraordinary in the sense that the hook of the song comes really in the last minute and a half. But something very memorable, something very different at its time.
Yeah, very anthemic. You know, this was particularly, you know, that latter section that came to be known as a section of a 90s song that many people identified with and recited. And it was a nice piece from that song, certainly. And Rain doing some stuff that only Rain could do when it comes to vocal capability.
In such a freedom, just from an artistic perspective, for him to allow himself to get to that place. He's a very young vocalist at this time, and he's letting things happen that many vocalists just would have been really inhibited against trying. And I think that it gave the band an immediate identity. His voice, the falsetto, all the little things he would do, which we'll talk a lot about as we weave in and out of the songs on this album, but he would get further away from that falsetto stuff as the band's career went on, which gives this album quite a legacy because he was doing things on this album that he wasn't able to do, say, 10 years later when they really morphed into a completely different band. So what comes after Superman's Dead? Automatic Flowers. No one knows why she's sad tonight. No one. Falsetto vocals kind of in full effect here. You said it perfectly, Toph, using the voice as an instrument. That's his specialty. It's what he's doing here. What really stood out to me about this song, though, was the bridge. You know, this song just kind of came and went for me until they get to that middle section where everything drops out but guitar and drums. The bass guitar drops out. And then it goes into that section where Rain is doing that high, you know, that really high vocal stuff. And it gave the bridge a real lift from a song that to me didn't have super dynamic verses and choruses. But one thing you'll find with Clumsy, an album of tremendous middle sections. This band could really write great bridges. And I think Automatic Flowers is an early example of that. What do you think of this song?
No, it's true. And also, you know, pre-chorus sections. There are a lot of those on this record that are really impactful, you know, and I think that was another element of a lot of these 90s bands were if the verses weren't quite your bag or the choruses weren't quite your bag, and we talked a little bit about it with Oasis, the ability to develop a pre-chorus or a middle eight or a bridge, whatever you want to call it, that catch your appeal, you know, that was something that a lot of bands at this time were able to utilize. And you're absolutely correct on this album. It's utilized, you know, brilliantly, both the middle sections as well as the pre-choruses. And one of the things that Rain's vocal capability was able to do, it really was able to take a lot of pressure off the rest of the band because it's not a big guitar solo band, and certainly this isn't a big guitar solo album. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that, you know, they were able to almost turn Rain's voice into a middle section solo in many cases. And I almost think that sometimes his voice substituted for guitar solos in many sections. So kind of takes pressure off the band in a way, and also, you know, gives you a differentiating way to be creative that many other bands don't have that capability to do.
Smart read. It's a very smart read. And I know there's a certain song come about mid-album that's quite beloved for exactly what you just described. But on the road to that, you got to make a stop at track 3, Carnival. You're frustrated. Toph, what do you think of Carnival?
I just think Jeremy Taggart's such a good drummer.
Oh, dude.
This song is all Taggart.
You know, I played in bands with our older brother. And one time he was getting really pissed off at the way I was playing. And he kind of had a little outburst. And he said, dude, you've got to play more like the Our Lady Peace guy. He's loose, but he's also tight. And he's tight, but he's also loose. And it was funny. Several years after that, when I was reviewing music, I had a chance to interview Jeremy Taggart, which was a complete thrill. And I told him that, you know, I said, man, my brother yelled at me for this reason. And he said, hey, that's my complete philosophy as a drummer.
Yeah.
Tight and loose and loose and tight. And he is just so good. And you're right. Carnival is a terrific example of his prowess.
Yeah. It's the type of song. I mean, you know, it's well put together and it's a nice track 3, but it's one of those. And I think there are probably going to be a few on this record that just wouldn't be what they are without his approach to drumming.
I also think that Carnival is maybe the first example where you see Arnold Lanny's production really come through. There's no keyboard credits, which can only lead me to think that Arnold Lanny, who's a fine multi-instrumentalist, did a lot of the keyboard treatments throughout the album. And the beginning of Carnival and some of the parts in that song do feature some pretty cool keyboard and synth parts. And you hear that throughout other parts in the rest of the album. It's a big song. It's the entrance into the chorus is a pretty memorable part of the album. And it leads nicely into track 4, Big Dumb Rocket. Kind of built around a basic rock riff, but man, the middle section of this song is just so catchy. I mean, I used to walk around like at school during the day and just go do 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 da do da da do da da. It, you know, again, Rain making it happen. I guarantee you that he sang that part. You know, by all accounts, he used to sing a lot of the middle sections, and they would take it from his vocal lines.
Yeah, you know, it's pretty good. I mean, obviously, you know, it's kind of a setup to the next track in a lot of ways. But, you know, you get 4 tracks into this album and you certainly realize that you're listening to something very creative. And I would say that was kind of the big differentiator between this and Navid was, you know, that had a lot of kind of straightforward, very driving. I mean, it was a great sound, very trademark Our Lady Peace sound, but it's a good point in the record to kind of understand that before you get into the next one.
4 a.m. This is the moment where Toph might need some Kleenex. Things might start getting emotional over here.
I just kind of had something in my eye. It's very dry in here. That's all that's happening.
I don't know. It looks like maybe a tear coming
down. No.
Okay.
No. Never.
So before I pass the baton to you to tell us about how this is one of your favorite songs of all time. A couple interesting things about this. Rain wrote the song at 4 a.m., which is why it is titled 4 a.m. But the subject matter of the song, for those of you who really pay close attention to lyrics, clearly is about his father. It's like a conversation with his dad. His dad's initials were AM. And the second that all that came together, Rain felt like he had something special because it was written at the same time that if you say the song title, it also means for his dad. Very, very sentimental stuff going on here, lyrically, musically, and everything in between. Toph, tell us about your thoughts on 4 AM.
Well, you can really sense that in the performance. I actually didn't know that, but you can really, you only need to listen to this song once to understand that there is an emotional, you know, very compelling element to it. So not surprising that it had some, you know, personal elements within the performance. We play music, we play cover songs, acoustic versions, and we do a lot of 90s stuff and 80s stuff and 70s stuff. And it's great. And we actually play 4 a.m. And I remember we had a gig. This was like 2 or 3 weeks after my son was born. And we were playing 4 a.m. And, you know, I got to kind of that last section of the song. And between the song and me now being a father and my kid being born a couple weeks before, I just started crying. You know, it was like we were like performing in this bar and, you know, playing this song that kind of brings down the mood a little bit. And literally while playing it, all these things kind of started running through my head and I just freaking cried, you know, which I don't do very often. So, but I think it's telling of why this song touched a lot of people. And I'm certainly one of them is just the power of, you know, not just the melody and the layering. And I mean, obviously it's another great middle section, but just, you can sense so much, you know, passion in this performance, pure emotion when he hits the high vocal at the end. I think it's just absolutely extraordinary. I adore this song. I probably always will. And it's a very special part of the album. To your point at the beginning, when you were talking about the Nerdy Deets, Done Dirt Cheap, and listing the singles, I remember literally spending months telling people, and I had a couple of really good friends that love this album, and I remember telling them, why isn't 4 a.m. on the radio? What is going on? Like, this is one of the most incredible songs I've ever heard. How is this thing? And, you know, because Clumsy was on and Superman's Dead was on, and, you know, it seemed like I said, it seemed like an eternity until this song really gained appeal. But I'll tell you what, when it did, and when it became a radio hit and more people got to, you know, got to hear it and got to absorb it, I think it became as special for many others as it did for me.
It's a great take. You know, Rain made when he wrote this song, 25 years old, you know, 27 when the album was released. Some pretty profound stuff for such a young artist. And I think that's what's key about Our Lady Peace. These were pretty young guys. Such a fresh voice, such a fresh sound compared to their peers. And 4 a.m. is a great example of that.
And the keys at the end just introduce such a spectacular layer. You know, I mean, it's one of those, an already, you know, very emotional song, and just made it even better.
It's a 5-song run that would rival pretty much anything else that came out during this era, maybe even in the whole decade of the 90s. And it leads you into Shaking. What you know, what you knew, why are you shaking? Why are you right? But I will be the only one who gives and lets you in tonight. Kind of always willing to do things with rhythms, with cut time and double time and going back and forth between different rhythmic patterns. You can do that when you have a drummer that's as amazing as Jeremy Taggart. What do you think of Shaking?
a little bit of a tweener song. I think it's, to me, it's kind of that song in between 4 a.m. and the title track.
Which does contribute to what I think is a brilliantly sequenced album. And what Shaking does indeed lead into is the title track, Clumsy.
Quiet or loud. And maybe you should sleep. And maybe you just need a friend as clumsy as you've been. There's no one laughing. You will be safe with me.
A song that did a lot of things. One of the things it did is kind of put the Moog synthesizer back on the map with the parts in the chorus and that middle section. And again, you've got that loud, quiet, loud thing going on, which this band, I mean, masterful job of dynamics on most of this album. And Rain's voice combined with that synthesizer part, I think was a huge part of the commercial appeal.
Yeah, that layer's outstanding. You know, Rain himself said that, you know, his favorite part of the song, not terribly surprising with Rain, is when everything breaks down and it's just the vocal. He actually said that this song was a real struggle within the studio, a real struggle to perfect. And it sounds like this song took weeks to record. So I think it was one of those, and sometimes this happens with a specific song or a specific project within the studio, is you kind of work on it, then you get away from it, then you go back to it, then it sounded like one of those deals, but probably ended up being extremely productive because some of these synth layers and some of these additional things that were done to really, you know, again, this album's all about plussing up sections and making them even better. But Rain said that until they decided to have that breakdown, you know, he knew they had captured kind of the appeal and emotion of the song that they were trying to get across. You know, I think their work paid off on this one. They probably knew when it was all said and done that they had something pretty special.
Yeah, they were truly building a house with this song, taking the necessary time to make it perfect. This is the one song on the album that feels like it was perfectionists being perfectionists. You know, the rest of the album does have kind of a more raw, almost spontaneous feel to it. This song feels like it was intended to be a hit single and constructed piece by piece to be a hit single. And that gets me to the next point about this band. You can't forget, as we talked about at the lead, how important it is that this band is Canadian. You know, and you look at the history of Canadian rock bands, there's just no pretension. But there is a history of wanting to be different. The band was completely different from what was going on in their era, and they stood out. Rush was completely different from the rest of their peers, and they stood out. The Tragically Hip was so different from their peers, and it stood out. But in no case, in those three good examples, was there ever an ounce of pretension in what they did. It all still came from a very genuine, authentic musical place. Our Lady Peace the same way. It's very obvious that these four guys were artists who wanted to be different from the rest of what was going on in 1997, but they didn't act like it. They didn't make it a point. They didn't come out with something shocking. They still came out with really pleasing songs that mainstream listeners could enjoy and that radio would love. But it was very different from what else was going on. And I think that's always been something that stood out about the band. And I've always attributed that to be that they're Canadian, because I think those are very Canadian traits.
Yeah, well said. I mean, and certainly they got experimental, I mean, with Spiritual Machines. And then they put out what could be argued was probably their most commercial effort thereafter with Gravity. So, you know, it's a band that definitely tried a lot of different things, went in a lot of different directions. I would say for the most part, at least during the first handful of albums, you know, they got it right more than they got it wrong.
Can we just get one thing out of the way? You and I love Spiritual Machines.
Yes.
Yeah.
I actually, my favorite album of theirs is Happiness Is Not a Fish That You Can Catch. I wasn't sure if you were going to pick that one or this one. And I'm glad you picked Clumsy. It's a super important album from this band and of this era. But I think Happiness is actually their strongest work top to bottom.
Yeah, incredible record, no doubt about it. Out of Clumsy comes a little bit for the punk rockers here. Hello, Oscar. I just hear like straight up Sex Pistols in this song. You know, it's the one song that really has very few complexities to it. He does do his little falsetto vocal thing in the chorus, which is very cool. But I see this as just raw, riffy, almost punk rock, just kind of a relentless song.
Yeah, it's cool. You know, it's kind of a driving number. Again, you know, you had Clumsy, which was again pretty emotional and anthemic, and it's a nice song to sort of bring you down from that. Not my favorite on the record, and again, it's kind of another tweener, you know, that worked itself in between two really really strong songs on this album as we get to the next one. But you know, it's good. It's okay.
It's Taggart time. Let You Down. First and foremost, great use of the hand claps.
Oh, great claps.
And again, like an MP3 might not capture that, but when you listen to the song on CD, those hand claps during the chorus, it's again, just a significant part of the catchiness of the song. Do you love Let You Down as much as I do?
Oh, yeah. So if 4 a.m., presented to me a great deal of frustration from a why isn't this a beloved song on the radio standpoint, I then shifted to Let You Down and asked the same question. It's like, okay, now it's Let You Down's turn. When is this one going to be the next Our Lady Peace classic? Because, and I'm still to this day, I'm shocked that this never took off as a single, because besides 4 a.m., I've always felt this to be the best song on the album. And that's saying a lot when you factor in Clumsy and you factor in, you know, some of the other songs that actually were very successful singles, but still a mystery to me in a lot of ways to this day that this song never took off as a single. So yeah, I think it's an incredibly strong song within this album and one that I'm shocked never took off.
Just a phenomenal drum performance by Jeremy Taggart. You know, if you could hear an isolated track of what's going on here with Jeremy Taggart behind the drums, it's a very intricate, complex part, but he plays it with such looseness and plays it with so much groove. And at the beginning, he's doing one feel. And then one of my favorite parts is at the end, the very end of the song, you get this payoff where the chorus riff is no longer tight. Everything's wide open. And it's just a huge rock out part to conclude the song.
Yeah, it's a beauty.
Taggart time continues a little bit with the story of 100 Isles. Strong rhythm section elements. I just love when the drummer's sort of carrying the band. I know I'm a little biased, but, you know, sometimes it happens.
He was extraordinarily important to this band and certainly to this album. It's a great intro. I think the song is, it kind of peaks at its intro. That's a very cool rhythm and a very cool, almost psychedelic kind of feel to it. Rest of the song's, you know, okay, but part of me wishes that first 15 seconds went on a little bit longer. But, you know, second to last track, creative, swirling, a little bit of psychedelia to it. You know, it's good.
It is sort of the token 90s, let's do some India type rhythms. And yeah. You know, it seemed like every band during this time at some point or another was doing a song that had some like Eastern rhythms in it.
It's the Kula Shaker move. you know?
Yeah, yeah, the coolest shaker thing. And it all stems from, you know, the first time George Harrison picked up a sitar and introduced it to the Western world. But there is a little bit of tokenness to that idea of, okay, here's the 90s band doing the Eastern thing. But I love the dynamics. I think that the loud, quiet, loud thing rings very true in this song, particularly in the verses, you know, when everything kind of crashes in after the more quiet section of the verse is a pretty cool section. So it leads you to a pretty dramatic conclusion. And again, something completely different to end the album. Clumsy ends with Car Crash. It holds an interesting place on this record, especially the way that it ends things and that sort of more sweeping, dramatic aspect of the dynamics is something that certainly paces this song and paces the album to a pretty dramatic ending.
It's an awesome closer. Yeah. I mean, it's, you know, it's different. It has a different tempo. It has kind of a different vibe, kind of a song without a chorus. It is a really intelligent way to close this record, certainly. And, you know, broken record, but just more goodness from Taggart. I mean, I feel like we're back on the Toto episode talking about Jeff Porcaro again, you know, but, yeah. but you know, there are a lot of similarities between the two guys in that, you know, there were probably guys with better chops, more speed that could do a lot of things on the drums that Jeremy Taggart perhaps couldn't have done as well. But when it came down to feel and groove, he had that ability to do that, much like a Jeff Porcaro type versus somebody who could, you know, bust out a 6-minute, you know, drum solo and get the roto toms going and, you know, hit the gong at the end and all that stuff that you saw with a lot of, you know, theatrical drummers who are all very good in their heydays. It takes a little something special to really be able to find that groove, find that power, have that touch. And those things don't necessarily come through by, you know, somebody, you know, shredding out a ridiculous, you know, drum solo or fill necessarily, but it comes from being able to kind of deliver within that space perfectly. And Jeremy Taggart's that type of drummer. And I think it's, you know, it's a song that showcases that, kind of leaving you on the way out. Showcases Rain's voice as one that in this track a bit more haunting, which I think comes off well. And again, the idea, as we talked about with 90s rock, of being minimalist, you know, you don't need to overdo it. You don't need to overlayer it. Cool, interesting, intelligent closer for this album.
While this band certainly is a core part of the mid to late 90s, this band was different. And Rain's vocal performance on Car Crash is similar to a lot of his other performances on the rest of the album, really stood apart and gave this band a strong identity against its peers without question.
Well, don't forget about track 12.
Track 12.
Well, there was a hidden track on this
one.
Oh,
let's hear the hidden track.
The hidden track. Not a lot of people knew about it.
Track 12.
Track 12.
Yeah. Hidden track.
Great drumming by Jeremy Taggart on that one too. At least in the video, at least.
I can't figure out what's better, that or the acoustic guitar from Josie Scott.
Both important.
Both very, very important. So that wraps up Our Lady Peace's Clumsy. Toph, the golden question. Did Clumsy matter?
You know, I think it did. I think it did matter at that time of a band that was taking a lot of these grunge ideas that, you know, had to have a certain grit and had to have a certain feeling to them. And they were able to take songs that could be layered in a different way without just, you know, stacking guitars on itself and, you know, howling vocals. I mean, this was a completely unique vocalist at the time. And this album really demonstrated this ability to be stripped down and simple, because it does sound like a 90s record, but it holds up in that, you know, you have a lot of these layering elements and these keys and these, you know, synth parts and different things that don't overdo it to the point where it sounds like festival rock, but certainly at that time gave people a lot of cleverness and a lot of creativity. So I actually do think this album mattered. I think it produced a couple of pretty timeless, you know, singles, you know, from that era that have held up extremely well. I personally do think that their next record, Happiness Is Not a Fish, was their best. So if I had to pick one to pop in, I would probably pick this second or maybe even third behind Spiritual Machines on the Right Day. But that just shows the strength of the band. You know, I mean, the first handful of records that this band put out really were outstanding, and they really did deliver for those that really got this band. So yeah, I think all in all, this album did matter of its time. And those that are willing to kind of go back and revisit it top to bottom, you know, again, you can't necessarily compare it to the Pro Tools era or to some of the layered sounds and songs that you hear today. But if you put yourself, you know, back in this time period where a lot of those things had yet to develop, these songs hold up extremely well. And I think of their time were very creative and very unique. What do you think?
I think it matters, but I think it should matter more. My issue with does it matter is that it really hasn't translated to a new generation of listeners. It kind of had us, sort of the Gen X, Gen Y listeners. It certainly had our attention and presumably still would if people went back and rediscovered it. But it hasn't caught on with a new generation of listeners. And that's what brings me back to the original conversation at the top. You know, how can an album this great not connect with newer listeners? So yes, I think it matters to certain generations of listeners. And I think it should matter more. In a more fair musical world, the album would matter more to a wider range of listeners. And to your point, maybe it will. You know, maybe we will hit a point where the 90s become more nostalgic and albums that deserve to be rediscovered by a new generation like Clumsy, maybe those will indeed get that treatment. So with that, let's go to the final cut. T, you tell me here in the final cut, is it on the turntable? Is it in the collection? Is it collecting dust? Or is it in the dreaded for sale bin?
For me, it's in the collection. And again, it's probably my second, maybe third favorite Our Lady Peace album. Soundly in the collection. It's again, I think it is an album that matters and is important. And I agree with you fully. I hope it does get rediscovered. How about yourself?
Oh, it's on the turntable. It's on the turntable because it really is very complete, with the exception of a couple songs that might be considered sort of duff tracks. Everything's got some imagination in it. There's so much just raw creativity. It reminds you of an era where rock bands could do things a little bit differently, and it didn't have to be danceable. And that's the thing I just continue to come back to with rock music from this era. I love that it was powerful. I love that it moved people. I love that it spoke to different emotions that we were all having when we were growing up in the 90s. But maybe more than anything, I just love that you don't have to dance to it to enjoy it.
Is that because you're a horrendous dancer?
Well, yeah, of course.
Is that a factor in this?
It's a factor. I would say it's a factor in this.
I mean, sometimes I just feel like dancing. You
just got to dance.
You want to dance tonight.
You ready to head back from Canada? We're taking the bridge home. You ready to get in the Ambassador Bridge?
Oh, I don't know. Do we have to? Can we stop at Tim Hortons? Well, back then, Tim Hortons, you know, was a Canada. Now it's, you know, I got one 2 minutes from my house. But back then it was a novelty.
All right, let's get in the Ambassador Bridge. Let's travel home and let's check out what is in your head. In your
head, in your head. They're still...
In your head, in your head.
They are.
Come on, Dolores, one more. Toph, what's in your head?
Three things. The first would be one of my all-time favorite ballads from the 80s, which is Never Surrender by the great Corey Hart.
Ooh,
a wonderful
great song.
And again, another one that we play together on our acoustic outings, but just an outstanding song and one that I think will hold up for a very, very long time. One of my favorite songs of the 80s and one of my favorite all time. It's hard to call it a ballad. It's actually pretty mid-tempo, but it is an absolutely gorgeous song. The second is also a gorgeous song, and this is one of my favorite ballads from the 90s, and it's by Blue Rodeo, and the song is called Lost Forever. Absolutely just beautiful, heartfelt. It certainly has become a song that I still listen to because it's just one of those that gets you. It's just gorgeous. And the third is not so much a ballad, but kind of a unique, rap kind of electronica song from the 90s by Brand Van 3000 called Drinking in LA. It was a pretty decent hit on a lot of alternative radio and a song that many people may not recognize the band, but certainly would recognize Drinking in LA if they heard it. And it was a song that was a little bit ahead of its time. It kind of reminds you of actually some more modern stuff that includes sort of hip hoppy type elements while also being essentially a pop track with a lot of electronica behind it. So great song there by Brand Van 3000. And I will pass it over to you. What's in your head, sir?
I saw a theme.
Oh,
I saw again? A theme in your what's in your head.
Again? No.
We never left. We didn't get on the bridge. We stayed in Canada because, again, three Canadian artists.
All right. I did it.
You know who's very proud of you right now is Stephen Abutman.
Yes. He's the president of the WGA, I believe.
The World Canadian Bureau.
World Canada Bureau. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. He's very proud of you right now. Yeah. What's in my head right now is not actually three Canadian artists, but is Once in a While by Dishwalla. Very important to say the live version of this song from the Greetings from the Flow State album. So always one of my favorite Dishwalla songs, but the live version is really what you want there with Once in a While.
That band has some great songs. I don't think Once in a While was on this, but they put out a self-titled album a few years later that just has a couple of rippers on it. I mean, that's a good band right there.
Yeah, it is. It is. Flying Colors, which is one of the newest progressive rock supergroups that features Mike Portnoy from Dream Theater, who I think is in every prog rock supergroup. But it's got Neil Morse and a few other kind of, newer prog musicians. Their most recent album has a song called Cadence. The album's called Third Degree because it's the band's third album. And Cadence is a real highlight of that particular album. And I recommend people to check that out, whether you're into prog or not. And then lastly, a song that I jammed to while rollerblading in the beautiful weather this week. And that was Space Hog's I Want to Live, which is off of the Hogacy album. I continued to follow Space Hog, even after Resident Alien and In the Meantime was out. And I Want to Live was one of those later singles that they had that was a pretty, pretty good jam. So that is what is in my head. Toph, I loved taking a trip back to the 90s with you. Loved it.
Well, and North of the Border. It was a lot of fun, a nice pick and a great album to revisit and appreciate you bringing it to the table.
Two great things, the 1990s and Canada. And when you combine them, you get very, very lovely results. See, we got to get our butts home. We got to get across the border. I mean, it's late.
We
still got to go through customs and we got to find our way back home. So let's find our way back home.
Who knows how long customs is going to take, especially if they decide to get that cavity search going now.
All right. Thanks everybody so much for tuning in. Make sure to check us out on our various platforms. Subscribe to us, leave us comments, and we'll see you very soon on the next edition of Two Twins and an Album.
Too disappointing. We will see you on tour. Until then, take it easy.